Thank you, Prof. Riyad, and welcome again to our attendee for the last part of our first session of this meeting. Will be satellite symposium. Will be presented by Prof. Zanzani. Prof. Zanzani is well known for all the Saudi Hematology Society. He's professor of hematology, Institute of Hematology, University of Bologna. He's principal investigator of more than 180 clinical trials, including national and international multicenter studies. Also, he was a president of Italian Foundation of Lymphoma from 2013 to 2015, and now he's member of the board of the directors. He's associate editor of Annals of Oncology from 2014 to 2017, and act as a reviewer for many journals. He has authored over more than 580 peer-reviewed papers in many journals, such as New England Journal of Medicine, Blood Journal of Clinical Oncology, and Lancet Oncology. His current research interests, including clinical trial methodology, prognostic factor in non-Hodgkin lymphoma and Hodgkin lymphoma and chronic lymphocytic leukemia, and new drug development and hairy cell leukemia. Prof. Zanzani, he will have a talk about optimizing outcome in cutaneous T-cell lymphoma, role of blood involvement and treatment option. Prof. Zanzani.
Thank you very much for the kind introduction, Dr. Tomali, and good afternoon to everybody. I want to thank also again my friends, Professor Dana Saiello. And we start. In the next 20 minutes, I will do an update concerning this issue, my conflict of interest. So, mogamulizumab, the story of mogamulizumab in the treatment of cutaneous T-cell lymphoma started with this phase one, phase two study published on 2015 on blood by the group of Mather and Jovic in MD Anderson. You can see here that they treated 38 patients, and at the end of the day, the overall response rate was close to 37%, with a very good activity in all the three different compartments. I mean, blood, skin, lymph node. This is a peculiar characteristic of this agent for the treatment in a cutaneous T-cell lymphoma. I mean, so overall, mycosis fungoides and Sézary syndrome. And at the same time, in terms of safety profile, you can see here in this table that grade 3 and 4 was close to zero. There was only one patient with a drug eruption with grade 3, the same grade 3 for two patients with nausea. And on the basis of this very interesting, promising, but preliminary data, started a phase 3 study. But first of all, you can see here that mogamulizumab is a humanized anti-CCR4 monoclonal antibody that markers for type 2 helper T cell and regulatory T cells and involved in lymphocyte trafficking to skin, and is overexpressed in the majority of ATL, peripheral T cell lymphoma, and also cutaneous T cell lymphoma, with a higher ADCC due to a defocalized FC region. So in particular, right now, this drug has a validation, a registration by Japanese FDA. I don't remember the name of the Japanese drug agency. Anyway, for ATL and also for peripheral T cell lymphoma. And with the MAVORIC study that I will present in a few seconds, there was also the official indication for cutaneous T cell lymphoma, not only FDA, but also EMA. So the mechanism of action is the target receptor, as I said before, is a CCR4. And after binding CCR4 in tumor cell, mogamulizumab induced ADCC. NK cells linked to FC region of MOGA on tumor cell, inducing the release of cytotoxic granules and the lysis of tumor cells. This is the study schema of MAVORIC is the largest phase 3 randomized study conducted and published in the treatment of cutaneous T-cell lymphoma. I was involved in this trial. We included 372 patients, and the key inclusion criteria were adults with stage 1B, 4B patients, histological confirmed of mycosis fungoid or Sézary syndrome, at least one prior course of systemic treatment, and of course, a good performance status. The study was quite easy. Random was 1-to-1, comparing mogamulizumab, 186 patients included in this study arm, at the conventional dose of 1.0 milligram per kilogram intravenous, according to the phase 1 study, and once weekly for first 4-week cycle, once every 2 weeks thereafter. And the standard arm was a vorinostat with the same number of patients, 186, at the conventional dose of 400 milligram OD orally for 4 weeks, according to the United States prescribing information, because as you know, vorinostat is an HDAC inhibitor with an official indication for relapsed refractory cutaneous lymphoma by FDA. There was a possibility also to have a crossover, a one-way crossover after disease progression or intolerable toxicity after two cycles or more than two cycles from vorinostat to mogamulizumab. The stratification was done according to the different histological subtype, I mean mycosis versus Sézary syndrome, and disease stage, 1B2 early stage versus advanced stage, stage 3 and 4. CCR4 expression was not a requirement for participation, and patient could continue treatment until disease, drug intolerance, or unacceptable toxicity. The primary endpoint was the investigator-assessed progression-free survival, and there were several secondary endpoints, such as overall response rate, duration of response, the patient-reported assessment of quality of life, overall response rate in the crossover population, and of course, safety profile. I think it's very important, as I said before, on the basis of the data presented by Madeleine Dubic in the phase 1, phase 2 study, that this kind of drug is really active in different compartments. I mean, skin, lymph node, and blood. And for the assessment of the skin, we use the modified severity weighted assessment tool, the MSWOT, every 4 weeks. For the assessment of lymph node, we use, of course, the CT scan. And for the assessment of blood, of course, the central flow cytometry assessed every 4 weeks with a stratification in three different subgroups, B0, B1, and B2. Inclusion criteria, as I said before, adult patient with an age at least of 18 years, 20 years in Japan, with histology, confirmation of histology of mycosis, fungoides, and Sézary syndrome, stage 1B, stage 4 disease, and who failed at least one prior systemic therapy. And you can see here the baseline characteristic of the 186 patients for each arm, mogamulizumab versus vorinostat. There are no statistically significant differences between the two subset of patients. And in fact, the number of prior systemic treatment, the median number was 3 for each of these subset, ranging from 1 to 18 for moga, from 0 to 14 for vorinostat. At the same time, you can see here that the percentage of mycosis fungoides was a little bit more than Sézary syndrome, roughly 55% versus 45% respectively. The primary endpoint was met. I mean, the median progression free survival according to the investigator assessment was 7.7 for MOGA versus only 3.1 months for vorinostat. and the P of course was statistically significant. And also, according to the different subgroup, the progression-free survival was all in all these subgroup in advantage of mogamulizumab arm. I mean, for the sex, according to the different age with the stratification at 65 years. Also, when you compare MF versus Sézary syndrome in early stage versus advanced stage, and also with different region, I mean United States, Japan, and Europe plus Australia. And also when you have normal or low or a low level of LDH versus elevated LDH level. In terms of response, according to the different compartments, you can see here in the skin, the overall response rate for MOGA was 42% with a CR of 4%. And at the same time, in the vorinostat group, the overall response rate was 16%. In the blood compartment, the overall response rate for MOGA was roughly 70% versus only 20% for vorinostat, with a CCR rate of 44% for MOGA versus only 4% for vorinostat. And finally, concerning lymph nodes compartment, the overall response rate was 17% for MOGA versus only 4% for vorinostat, and the CR rate was 8% for mogamulizumab versus 2% for vorinostat. So you can see here that in all the three different compartments, there is a high advantage in terms of overall response rate, the CR rate for mogamulizumab versus the standard arm. And also in terms of waterfall plot of best skin response and also best global response, you can see a huge difference when you compare the waterfall plot for mogamulizumab versus the vorinostat waterfall plot comparing the two groups. In terms of safety profile, the median duration of exposure was roughly twice as long for mogamulizumab, I mean 170 days, than for vorinostat, only 84 days. And in terms of adverse event leading to discontinuation was 19% in MOGA subset versus 23% in vorinostat subset, and adverse event leading to death, only 3 patients, 1.6 in the mogamulizumab arm versus 9 patients, I mean 5% in the vorinostat arm. In terms of commonly reported treatment emergent adverse event, you can see here for mogamulizumab grade 3 and 4, the infusion related reaction was less than 2%, drug eruption was reported in 8 patients, I mean 4.3%, and this was the same data close to the phase 1, phase 2 study. And in terms of hematological toxicity, there was no grade 3 and 4, and also a few patients had the fatigue grade 3 and 4, and only one patient's nausea grade 3 or 4. And on the basis of this trial, there was this final publication concerning upon the final result of MAVORIC. And the basis of the publication, there was also, as I said before, the official indication by FDA concerning the activity of mogamulizumab in the treatment of Sézary syndrome and mycosis fungoides, of course, all relapse refractory patients, the same situation for the European Drug Agency, so EMA. And on the basis of the summing up of this study, it was the first report of a randomized phase 3 study, I mean the largest phase 3 study in this kind of disease, comparing a new systemic treatment like mogamulizumab versus one of the conventional ones. And MOGA, a first-in-class monoclonal antibody targeted CCR4, demonstrated significantly superior efficacy outcomes compared to vorinostat in patients with previously treated cutaneous lymphoma, independently by mycosis fungoides or Sézary syndrome. The primary endpoint, the median progression of survival, was a statistically significant advantage of mogamulizumab, 7.7 months versus only 3.1 months. And also in overall response rate was again a statistically significant in advantage of mogamulizumab, 28% versus only roughly 5% for vorinostat. In particular, in terms of overall response rate in the blood compartment, for mogamulizumab was close to 70% versus only roughly 20% for the control arm. Patient reported quite a lot of outcome demonstrated significant improvement with mogamulizumab, and the safety profile was consistent with previous report, and common adverse events were really manageable. This study supports mogamulizumab as a valuable new therapeutic option in the treatment of relapsed refractory patients with cutaneous T-cell lymphoma. I want to do an update concerning the post-hoc analysis concerning two issues. The first one is efficacy and safety by blood classification, and the second one is the responder cohorts. For the first, mogamulizumab is better than vorinostat in blood compartment, as I said before, and in the question is what happens by blood classification. And these data are really very interesting because you can see here, when you compare the result in terms of clinical response, I mean overall response rate of MOGA versus the study arm, the conventional arm, vorinostat, according to the three different cohort, B0, B1, and B2, you can see here that overall response rate for MOGA was 15% for B0, 26% for B1, and close to 38% for B2, versus only no more than 6% in the three different cohort for vorinostat. And of course, the B was statistically significant. And this data, I think, is very important because you can have also a rebound in terms of longer progression-free survival in the three different cohort of B0, B1, and B2 in advantage of mogamulizumab patients versus vorinostat patients. Another important point is concerning the time to the next treatment. And you can see here again that when you compare MOGA activity versus vorinostat is the three different cohort, B0, B1, and B2, the time to the next treatment is close to 7 months for B0, more than 1 year for B1, and 13 months for B2, versus only 4 months in B0 for vorinostat, 3 months in B1, and again 3 months in P2 for vorinostat. Again, what the P was in the majority of this cohort statistically significant. And again, you can see here in the curves the real important data concerning the median progression response, the time to the next treatment, the median time to the next treatment for B0, P1, and B2, in particular for MOGA, the red curve versus vorinostat, the black curves. And another important point is related to the median duration response. The median duration response with MAVORIC was 14.1 months. And you can see here the overall response at 4 months, at 6 months, 8 months, and 1 year was 25%, 21, 16, and 10 months. Respectively, and in all these evaluation, there was a huge advantage, a higher response, overall response rate for mogamulizumab when you compare with vorinostat. The same situation in terms of overall response rate, if you stratify the patient according the response according to the three different compartments, blood, skin, and lymph node, with a different time of 4 months, 6 months, 8 months, and 1 year. And the last two, three slides are concerning the real world experience with mogamulizumab. The first one was this publication the last year from the British group concerning the real-world experience using mogamulizumab in relapsed refractory patients with mycosis fungoides and Sézary syndrome in a pediatric area. They treated nine patients with a very interesting result. And at the same time, this is the case report that we published from my experience in our institution. As I said, I was involved in the Maori study. I included 19 patients, and this patient is one of them. It was a diagnosis of Sézary syndrome in 2011, stage 4A. And you can see here the long list of prior treatment lines with CHOP in 2011, and then extracorporeal apheresis plus bexarotenin, and then the total skin irradiation in 2014. Again, bexarotenin repeated in 2014. And finally, also another conventional chemotherapy in 2015, like GEMOX regimen. The patient was enrolled in Maverick in July 2015, and he was in the mogamulizumab arm, and was treated with moga until October 2017. So I mean for more than 2 years, roughly 27 months. The treatment was stopped because of non-lymphoma skin plaque for some toxicity. But the picture baseline before to start with moga and after 10 cycles of mogamulizumab. And right now, after more than 4 years from 2017, when the patient stopped the treatment with moga, the patient continues to be in continuous complete response without any kind of other consolidation. And this, I think, is very important because it's a very long period of continuous complete response that is quite strange to observe in this disease. And we did for several times in different sites skin biopsy, and all of them were absolutely negative. And finally, I want to remember also to visit the brand of new hub concerning this product by Kirin Kara. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Prof. Zinzani, for this update regarding the option of cutaneous T-cell lymphoma, which is, as you know, it's poor prognosis, especially in elderly. Prof. Zinzani, we have 3 minutes, maybe we'll have two questions. The first one, as you mentioned in the inclusion criteria of the trial of mogamulizumab, the majority of the population was fit patient, especially ECOG 0 and 1. Do you think if we extend the inclusion criteria to have more fragile patients, how will it affect the tolerance for the medication?
I'm sorry, I don't hear the last part of your questions.
Regarding the inclusion criteria in the trial of mogamulizumab,
yeah.
Majority of the patient was fit patient, ECOG 0 and 1. What do you think if we extend the inclusion criteria to have more fragile patients, will affect the tolerance for the medication?
This could be an option, considering that the safety profile, as I showed a few minutes ago, is really good. So there are no grade 3 and 4. The real problem could be drug eruption, but it's very well controlled. But there are no cardiac toxicity, no lung toxicity, no renal toxicity. And this, I think, is fundamental to try to, in the future, to include also fragile patients for this kind of treatment.
Okay, excellent. Another question, Prof. Zinzani, regarding the combination of the mogamulizumab with other agents, especially monoclonal anti-CD30.
Yeah, we discussed several times with the company. This could be another option also because there is a very good activity with two different targets and potential without any kind of cumulative toxicity, but also could be another option also, why not to think in the future to use mogamulizumab also like a consolidation / maintenance treatment after frontline treatment for cutaneous T-cell lymphoma, because we need some, so the concept could be to have like an induction treatment, then to continue Mogamulism Alliance consolidation, to convert from PR to CR, or at least to maintain the response obtained with the first regimen.
Okay, excellent. Thank you, Prof. Zinzani, for your answer. By this, we end our last part of the session one.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.